So upcoming, the Rip and Read with Curtis Sliwa. Nancy Sliwa should be here, but she's feeling under the weather. She's a little bit ill because she was forced to go out into this weekend's downpour just to get a cup of coffee, and she got sick. Curtis Sliwa didn't want to get his beret wet.
Because it just was brutal.
Now, I'm sure you must have offered to go for her, being a gentleman.
Couldn't reach her on the cell phone. If she took that cell phone out, it would have been destroyed. You know, I could understand that.
Look, deflecting with the cell phone, you should have said before she went, I can go for you. My love, my sweet, my my wife.
She's stubborn. She's addicted to a cup of coffee. I told her, be careful. They expect a squall. She went to the first Java joint. As I repeated yesterday, it was closed. It should have been a signal to her. Return to WABC. But oh no, it started raining cats and dogs. And she got all wet, finally found a cup of Java, a cup of coffee. And now look at her. She probably has walking pneumonia. She's got a sore throat. She'll end up with strep throat. She'll be bedridden. Because she wouldn't listen to me. Wouldn't listen to me. Stubborn. You know, she was sort of like the equivalent of Matthew Perry being addicted to ketamine. She's addicted to coffee and the caffeine in coffee like you.
But again, you've got the red jacket on, you've got the red beret, you're well protected against the elements. Why didn't you go out and get the coffee?
Because sometimes you have to hit bottom before you give up your addiction, right?
Oh, okay,
You've heard that, right?
It was like an intervention of sorts.
Exactly. See, if I had intervened, I would have just kept feeding the beast.
Okay, so she has to get sick to learn her lesson.
Exactly. Now, as you know, Sid Rosenberg this morning read a great text from Kelly Dillon, our colleague at 1010 WINS, who was brutally attacked and mugged and is now recovering from a concussion. And I think in solidarity, because you sometimes a little insensitive to women's needs, as you have berated Noam Layden for wearing his Swifties for Kamala shirt on a regular basis. You know, he went through the Rust Belt on his vacation touring with his Swifties for Kamala shirt and being well-received in those blue areas. So I'm suggesting that you run the gauntlet. I want you to do this because you go to the Port Authority to get your bus back to Bloomfield, right?
Okay.
So I want you to wear your shirt proudly, Hillbillies for Trump.
Okay, Hillbillies for Trump,
right.
Wear that.
Walk up that corridor, that 8th Avenue corridor, uh-huh, on like 34th Street.
Gotcha.
Right on up to the Port Authority.
All right. I mean, you don't think some of the people standing around are going to give me a hard time?
No. I know those homeless, you know, emotionally disturbed.
Yeah. Okay.
They can't even read that shirt.
All right. They don't care.
But as you see the Jackie Gleason statue.
Yep. I know it well.
Of the bus driver.
Mm-hmm.
I want you to make a left, go into the Port Authority, and I guarantee you there will be some New York Times people across the street. That's their headquarters. And they will start, they will run across the street, they will give you a beat down, they'll start beating daylights out of you with hard copies of the New York Times.
The New York Times staff.
Yeah, but they hate
you. They're coming for me.
That's right.
You can't wear that shirt near them.
Oh, okay, exactly. And their headquarters is right across the street.
I know.
Come on, please.
So you're saying that I should, in solidarity with Miss Dillon, wear this shirt and allow myself to be assaulted by members of the New York Times staff?
Why not? Run the Apache line. Let's see if it happens. Remember, they got cameras.
Do you think they're going to, like, roll up newspapers and hit me with that?
Yes.
Do they still actually sell a physical copy
of the
newspaper?
Yes, the hard copies. Yeah, look, on Sundays, I'm in the Upper West Side with Nancy. The Altacacas, they line up to buy the hard copies. They'll spend a whole day in Starbucks, you know, nursing one cup of coffee, and they read every section, including the letters to the editor that they argue over.
But you probably like that, because one cup of coffee is very healthy, very moderated.
Cup,
you know,
coffee.
Just one cup is fine.
Yeah, but apparently there is an article in that venerable New York Times that Starbucks is not like the old Starbucks. Can you believe that? They spent like 5 pages.
Yeah, because it cost you like $8 to get
not
a latte.
Not even the cost. The quality of the bean.
Oh, really?
You see, they had the connoisseurs. The same people who test the wine, you know, they squeakle it in their mouth and then they spit it out into a spittoon.
Yeah.
Apparently, they have people who do that also with the coffee.
Oh, yeah, sure.
You know, they taste it. You and Nancy should do that.
Well,
and then spit it into the spittoon.
I agree. We should have like a big tasting of the different coffees. But see, to me, I kind of look at coffee like pizza.
You know, even like bad coffee, it's still good. It's still coffee. I'll drink the coffee, you know, from anywhere. Right? A K-cup machine.
Oh, yeah, because it's free. Let's face it. You throw nickels around like manhole covers, hillbilly. It's free, so you'll take anything free, right?
You're kind of right on
that. By the way, you should have seen it today. You were in the kitchen. I was making myself a cup of tea.
Right.
Remember? And I forgot there was no cup.
You burned your hand.
I had my hand in there.
Directly in this line of fire.
The water started streaming down the hot water.
I've never heard you scream that high pitch.
I know,
before.
But I had to hold it in. I had to be a man's man. I didn't get the ice right away as my hand began to balloon up. It looked like I had a Yogi Berra catcher's mitt on.
You were kind of like wearing it like a badge eye. You're telling everybody, oh, I burned my hand.
That's right, but you don't see me. I'm not putting my hand in that freezer, that ice box. I don't put some ice cream. I can spit on it. In fact, it's too bad it's one day after International Dog Day. I would have had a dog licking.
That's right.
That would have resolved it. Although the best, when you got a burn like that, the natural aloe vera plant, which I've had to use a few times in my life, not the ointment that you buy that was stolen in Duane Reade by some guy doing shoplifting, but the actual aloe vera plant they sell in supermarkets and obviously at places where they sell plants other than marijuana. Aloe vera, right?
No, I've heard you mention that.
I smeared my hand with the aloe vera.
Oh, you did? You used it.
Look
okay.
at that.
Yeah, it looks fine.
You saw it before. It looked like Yogi Berra's old catcher's mitt.
That's true.
You see, I can take it. I'm a man's man. Meantime, what a mamaluke, Frank Morano.
I was going to ask if you wanted to get into the port.
Well, remember, you're passing Jackie Gleason,
yes.
right?
Mm-hmm.
The greatest bus driver of all time on the Honeymooners. And you're waiting for your Port Authority bus, New Jersey Transit bus, always 4 hours late, to take you to Bloomfield. There is a great story in Newark, New Jersey.
Mm-hmm.
To me, it's very clear. Why don't you indicate what happened to that Jackie Gleason bus driver?
All right. So in this case, the bus driver was minding his business, driving the bus. That's his job. When one of the passengers spit on him, hocked a loogie and spit on him.
Hmm.
And obviously the bus driver was none too pleased. He actually beat the ever-loving daylights out of this guy.
I played that video about 20 times. It was better than pornography.
Yeah, so he didn't just take it standing down, or sitting down, let's say.
If you haven't seen it, ladies and gentlemen, if you watch pornography, forget pornography. This touches every ounce of machismo that you have in your body.
To the point where some of the passengers were getting a little uncomfortable and saying, oh, hey, maybe you better take it easy there, buddy. You know,
why didn't they just jump in and put a boot to the back of that?
I'm not sure.
The guy, the spit is back.
I wasn't there. But yeah, basically,
Tyrone Walker.
And both of them, the spitter and the bus driver, got arrested.
How do you like that? Hey, what did Raj Baraka say, the pro-criminal mayor who wants to destroy the state of New Jersey and become your governor, huh? Did he make comment? This is a brother. Tyrone Walker is driving his bus. If you've ever been in Newark, Broad and Market, where all the buses congregate, oh, my God, what those bus drivers have to put up with.
I'm out of me.
That's right. And yet he decided that's it. He beat the hell out of this guy. He put him into a sleeper hold. I'm surprised he's not offered a contract by the WWE. He was so good on that bus. Not easy to maneuver around. And yet, the other side of midnight, to show you what a mamaluke Frank Morano is. Gnome Layden introduced the story to him. Gnome usually jumps on from 4:30 to 5 before, thank God, it's time to exit Frank Morano out of the studio and make way for Gnome Layden's one-hour newscast. And Noam asked him a simple question. Simple.
The bus driver and the passenger were arrested. But when you talk to passengers now who are on this bus ride, they say, thank God this bus driver fought back. And they say he was right to fight back.
Mm. Well, I mean, I think on a moral level and maybe an ethical level he was, but legally you can't do that. I mean, it's terrible to be spit upon. But unfortunately, especially as a bus driver, you can't start raining blows upon this person past the point, well, really at all, but certainly past the point where he's already subdued. I would think that they're both going to probably face some charges here, but you can't do that. I understand it. I understand why he was kind of tested beyond his limits, and it's a shame that that this spitter put him in this position, but you can't do that. It's a real shame. It's a big no-no.
A big no-no.
Big
right?
No-no. Big no-no. It's a real shame.
You know, he must be preparing himself for a political career because he gave a political answer there, like a politician. He talked all around the subject. But Frank Morano, the Mameluke, is a sanctimonious hypocrite like all politicians, Republicans or Democrats, and I'll tell you why. As you know, I am a constant critic of him on the better side of the other side of midnight that I host Saturday mornings from 12 to 6 in the morning. So nice, the suits then let me do it twice Sunday mornings, 12 midnight to 6. And I have condemned, I have given him condemnations. And you know what his response has been to me?
I want to spit upon you. Puh! Puh!
Wow.
Could I hear that again, please, Jim?
I want to spit upon you.
Spit.
Puh, puh.
Puh, puh.
You see spit. What a sanctimonious hypocrite?
I find that stunning because, I mean, again, not but several minutes ago, we were hearing the audio of Frank Morano clearly condemning, along legal grounds, the concept of,
of course,
of spitting.
But this is so common. Do as I say, but not as I do. You know, he's ready to become a politician. There's no doubt. But I do hope that our news director, Noam Layden, proudly wearing his Swifties for Kamala shirt on, at 4:30 in the morning when there is the handoff, when he speaks with Frank before the one-hour great newscast of Noam from 5 to 6, that he now confronts him with the hypocrisy that Frank Morano is guilty of. Could I hear that one more time, Lou, please, Frank Morano?
I want to spit upon you. Puh! Puh!
So he doesn't take the back of the bus driver who is constantly being harassed. He thinks the spitter is on the same level as the bus driver.
Well, I guess it's because he himself has desires and wants to spit on people.
On me.
Specifically you, right. Yeah.
Well, let me tell you something. Frank Morano, you mameluke, oofa to you. And hey, you with your Hillbillies for Trump shirt. It's time for you to walk on up 8th Avenue over to the Port Authority
and
get the hell out of here.
I want to spit upon you. Puh! Puh!
Curtis Sliwa! Curtis Sliwa! Rip and Reed! Check this out.
This is the Rip and Reed featuring Curtis Sliwa.
Talking about
now. To the Bernard McGurk Studios of 77 WABC and Curtis Sliwa. This is the Rip and Read.
This is the theme that women must adopt here in New York City if they are to survive. Oftentimes, they are like Bambi in the middle of hunting season, wearing orange fluorescent vests as the hunters. The predators out there, whether they're homeless, emotionally disturbed, or psychotic, just prey on women all the time. Recently, my wife Nancy will join us soon, under the weather. Talked about how 50 women in 1 month alone were attacked below 14th Street in Manhattan. Most of them on video, few if any arrests. And the war on women all over the five boroughs continues. The media downplays it. The mayor is always saying crime is down. And, of course, the police department acts like, it's not a big problem. Well, it is not only a problem, it affects all folks, no matter who they are. And it affected one of our own, Kelly Dillon. She took to TikTok as a 1010 WINS reporter, although she has a stellar career that spans over 20 years, having been over at Bloomberg Radio, traffic reporter in Connecticut for years, 101.5 in New Jersey, Good Day New York, Channel 5, WCBS Radio 880, unfortunately, having to ended signal. Boy, that's a tragic loss. And now a 1010 WINS. She was viciously mugged while leaving her job in Lower Manhattan.
A couple days ago, I was assaulted on the streets of New York City randomly by a man. And I want to share my story because I want to warn females about the dangers in the streets of New York City right now. There are crimes, many crimes being committed, random acts, random attacks on females on the streets, and it's not going away, and it's not getting any better, and it's getting much, much worse. And the media and the police are definitely downplaying this, and it is a huge, huge problem. The man who randomly attacked me, little did he know, I am quite tough. I am actually also a news reporter. I've been a news and traffic reporter in New York City for the past 20 years, and also I'm very intuitively open. So I am going to use my platform for good to help expose this further and hopefully catch these people committing these horrific acts towards women.
Notice she condemns her own fraternity and sorority in the media for downplaying this, along with the mayor and the police leadership. You know, this is the mayor's common knee-jerk reaction to these horrific crimes against women all over the five boroughs.
What we must do is remove the perception of fear. Cases like this.
Yeah, that's all he ever says, perception of fear. And women are being hunted down in the streets. And there are no consequences. To Kelly Dillon's point, every day, a lead story has to deal with women being attacked. The most recent up in the Bronx, there was a woman who was returning deposit bottles and she was putting it into the machine that then gives you the slip that you can redeem inside of the supermarket at 212th and White Plains Road in the Bronx at about 7 p.m. A man and a woman came up to her and brutalized her. An 82-year-old woman, William Ballinger and Tammy Moore. This crime duo stomped her. I mean, they took her head. They bashed it into the curb. A vicious assault that took place on August 2nd. Again, nobody stopped to intervene. The cops did not arrive. And it took 2 weeks for the cops eventually to track down these two attackers, no doubt, of women, and it turns out that both of them have long rap sheets that involve assault. The prosecutors, Darcell Clark in the Bronx, actually did the right thing and asked for bail, $30,000 apiece cash bail, for William Ballinger and Tammy Moore. And in this case, again, if it isn't the DAs who are cutting them loose, it's the judges. You had one suspect who went before Eugene Bowen. This guy is infamous. I think originally in the Bronx he was elected to civil court, and they transferred him to criminal court. It's like, why? He's always turning people loose? The most recently, two guys who attacked a police officer, no bail, don't remand him to jail, just turn him loose. In this case, he turns Ballinger loose. Doesn't give any reason. No, I'm in black regal robes. I can do whatever I want. And then you have the other, Craig Ortner, for the woman assailant, and he turns her loose. Again, we don't have to tell you why we let them walk. And they always use this explanation that they cut the suspects loose without remanding them to jail, no bail, because they're on supervised release. As I've told you, there's no such thing as supervised release. No such thing. There aren't enough probation officers. You can take, if they put a monitoring device on you, and again, it's amazing. You walk out of court, they don't put the monitoring device on you at that point. You got to go to the sheriff's department. It's like a racket. They can take that monitoring device, put it around the neck of their dog or cat who's walking all over the apartment, and it makes it seem like they haven't violated the orders of their supervised release. It's specious. It doesn't exist. There's another case just on Sunday. A mumbling New York City maniac beats a 66-year-old grandma in a random attack in broad daylight in Brooklyn. Again, nobody jumps in to help grandma. These are all women being attacked. Kelly Dillon of WINS is exactly correct. She's recovering from a concussion. And a high five to my colleague, Sid Rosenberg, who read a text from her this morning because he had reached out to her. And he said on behalf of himself and me, because obviously my primary role is at the Guardian Angel Patrol in the streets with the other men and women who are volunteers, that we're going to prioritize this. Because this mayor certainly doesn't. What does this mayor say whenever there's another case of a woman being attacked?
What we must do is remove the perception of fear. Cases like this.
Yeah, cases like this. The perception of fear. We will help Kelly Dillon. We will help women in need who are under attack. Because the police, hey, they just say, hey, crime is down. Lies. The mayor, he's delusional. And the media downplays it. Kelly's exactly correct. So at least here at WABC, we will help her in a cause to protect women who get victimized in this city every day, and nobody seems to care except for their family and friends. Well, we care here at WABC, and we're going to join Kelly and do something about it.
This is the Rip and Read featuring Curtis Sliwa. Now to the Bernard McGurk Studios of 77 WABC and Curtis Sliwa.
Today is National Radio Day, and this thing of ours is so personal. It is the most intimate form of communication that has ever been created. Some think by Marconi, the Italian, that's me. Others credit to Serbian Tesla, but doesn't matter. It's available to all of you old-timers like myself, the terrestrial radio, and so many new ways to listen. You know, from downloading your WABC app in your smartphone, your iPhone, you can take it with you and listen wherever you are in the world. And, of course, on your stream, on your laptop or your worktop computer, so many different ways to listen. And they've always said, well, radio will die. Yeah, they've predicted the death of radio at least a half a dozen times in my lifetime, and I'm 70. And yet, it gets stronger and stronger. It is under attack. In the House of Representatives and in the Senate, where they are being wind-dined in pocket line not to defend AM radio from those who manufacture cars. So new cars, they want it so that if you want an AM radio connection, you got to pay for it instead of making sure it's there, because it is the one measure for national security. If all else fails, we are the go-to station, WABC, the emergency broadcasting network to let people know what is going wrong. Could be a cyber attack on the grid. It could be any number of situations. It's AM radio that must persevere. And yet, on the Hill as we speak, both Republicans and Democrats are being wine-dined and pocket-lined against the enemies of AM radio. Because it's all about the money. Follow the money. That's why I don't trust any politicians. Don't trust them. To me, it's verify first, and then I'll trust you. But boy, you drop a wallet in a crowd of elected officials, and it's like a mosh pit diving to grab that wallet, because it's all about the money. But let's talk about National Radio Day. There's so many good memories that I have of radio as a youngster. You know, my first show that I ever heard on radio talk show was Bill Mazur, WNBC Sports Talk Radio, first sports talk radio on in the early evening. And it was great. But rather than go through a whole panoply of great shows that I've listened to, both AM, Active Minded, and on the FM side, as you know, Justin Ellick, FM stands for Freaking Morons, Feeble Minded, Fornicating Madly, Free Marijuana, and Mama Luke Frank Morano. But I've heard great programs on both. But I just want to sort of divide it up, PM and AM, the two greatest that I've ever heard. Without a doubt, the greatest talk radio in the history of this medium of ours is Bob Grant. He gave me my opportunity. He was my mentor. He could shift into a million different directions like nobody else. There's no one that was comparable to Bob Grant. And he could make or break somebody running for office. He beat Mario Cuomo with George Pataki than nobody knew. You could have elected Zippy the Chimp. More people knew Zippy the Chimp than George Pataki from Peekskill. But the king of talk radio, Bob Grant, took him under his wing. And he was able to defeat a man on his way possibly to becoming president, Mario Faccia Brutta Cuomo. Likewise with, she was so ungrateful. I'm not even going to mention Whitman. Witless. Oh, my God, she stabbed Bob in the back. Without the guidance of Bob taking her on the diner tour, there was like 600 diners in New Jersey, she would have lost to Jim Florio. And it was Bob Grant who termed Florio free in 93. He can make you, he can break you, but more importantly, he was the greatest talk radio host because he could entertain you. And the best was when he took on Mario Faccia Brutta Cuomo.
Hey, Mario, tu sei proprio uno sfaccino. Actually, we forgot to say, Mario, listen to me. Translation, Mario, listen to me. You're absolutely a scoundrel. Okay? Translated. Mario, asenta me. Tu sei proprio uno sfaccino. Si, proprio uno is absolutely. And sfaccino, according to scholars, is a scalawag, scoundrel, lowlife. You get it? Okay.
All of this would apply to Andrew Evil Eyes Cuomo now as he plots his political comeback after destroying the state of New York and now wants to destroy the city by running for mayor. Bob Grant had so many fans that he called a summit, a Mario Faccia Brutta Cuomo summit at Brown's, the hotel and catering hall up in the Catskills. 4,000 Grant fans showed up wearing the Mario Cuomo Sfachim shirt. And this is what they sang in unison.
And Bob, I haven't heard the Mario song all week. Do you mind if I indulge?
Go right ahead, Marty.
Mario was in the May. Do the Oproviano Sfachim. He can run New York State, but all the streets are full of hate. When he comes to town, here is what we say. Mario was in the May. To the Aproviano Sfachim. Mario, Mario, Mario.
Oh, magnificent. And then, of course, he had a series called the Mario Cuomo Adventures of the Sfachim. Oh, man, it's like it was happening yesterday.
That was before he went into the phone booth, did not say Shazam and came out as Captain Marvel. He said Sfachim and came out as the Sfachim. You know, that'd make a good comic strip. The Adventures of the Sfachim.
Oh, so good. And then when he'd take on the callers, even callers who were sycophants, toadies, and lackeys, which everyone in the business loves to be stroked, not Bob. Bob would go right after them.
And let me tell you something, Dave. I don't like to turn away listeners. That's not what this business is all about. Quite the contrary. This business is about attracting listeners and keeping listeners.
Yeah, but
I got to tell you the truth, Dave. I got to tell you the truth. You're one of the dumbest people to ever call me.
Thank you.
Yeah, you really are. You really are dumb. And with that, he hung up.
Masochist. People would call up, I love you, Bob. Bob, you're the way. And he'd get off my phone, you jerk. You don't hear that. You don't hear that. He's right. The business is developed so that you want to keep as many listeners as you can. Bob Grant didn't care. He had so many listeners. And then from time to time, he'd call them out. That's right. It would be like mano mano.
Hey, listen, Ron, sometime I want you to show up. when I'm making a public appearance. I want you to identify yourself.
I don't step into the courts of Satan, houses of iniquity.
I want you to identify yourself so that I can punch your stupid nose down your dumb throat.
I'll step on you, yo, man.
You'll step on me, yeah. Huh? Get off my phone.
Perfect. And there were times at the old WABC, the people would be waiting downstairs, Justin Ellick. Bob Grant would walk right in. He didn't take the back door. He didn't come in through a garage. They had no idea he was as short as he was, because if you listen to Bob Grant, you thought he was a big guy. He was ominous. He was going to punch your schnoz right down your throat. He'd walk right in, and people didn't even know it was Bob Grant, because it wasn't a day when everybody who did radio was on TV. Especially like with Paul Harvey. You almost didn't even know what he looked like. You know, there was a time, it was during the Christmas holiday. Paul Harvey was sitting in the newsroom of the old WABC with his wife. He was tending to some business there because we carried his 15-minute broadcast each year. The news department was there, and they didn't even know it was Paul Harvey. And then finally somebody tells me, you know, Paul Harvey was here. Paul Harvey was from Chi-Town, Chicago. I said, well, you're kidding, and you didn't tell us? They had no idea. He said, I didn't know what he looked like. I just heard his voice every day from 11:45 to 12, right after 45 minutes of the rip and read from Ed Koch. And it's true. Most people didn't know what Paul Harvey looked like. He was one of the greats. So we divided that up, PM, greatest of all time, Bob Grant, on this National Radio Day, and the greatest AM of all time, the Looney Kazooney from Parts Unknown, from Paterson, New Jersey, Art Bell. He was the king of theater of the mind.
The show, it's crazy. I mean, it's all kinds of things. Tonight, we're going to do open lines. And just as an example, we have a guest, you know, the first four nights of the week, and then the fifth night, I do open lines. And we're going to be talking to people tonight who have made a deal with the devil.
Oh, it was so good. And I had my battles with Art Bell. I was on before him at the old WABC. And he understood. He understood theater of the mind as well as anyone. I mean, if time permitted, I could have talked about Long John Nebel and Candy Jones and the old WMCA when that was the powerhouse here. He had us believing that Candy Jones was a CIA agent. He was the overnight guy. Alan B. Combs. When he didn't do politics, again, great with theater of the mind overnight. Lynn Samuels, the best female ever in talk radio. Eccentric, but incredibly talented, incredibly talented. And, of course, if we look to FM, Allison Steele, the Nightbird, a freeform WNEW radio, at least for me, the all-time best. National Radio Day is so important. Because so many of us prefer radio, as I do, to what you see on television or videos or anything else, because it stimulates the mind. And right now I want to stimulate all of you to join us, me and Nancy, on Sunday, September 29th, because listeners get a chance to donate to our individual teams here at WABC for the annual Tunnel to Tower Walk and Run. You can go to WABCradio.com/walk and click on my picture with Nancy and to donate. This way you're on our team. Please help me and Nancy raise the most shimolis for the amazing Tunnel to Towers Foundation Walk and Run. That's WABCradio.com/walk. Click on my picture with Nancy to donate. Every dollar helps. And believe it or not, I believe I and Anthony Weiner, when he was congressman, and then there was Congressman Fasella, and then the schmuck to putz, Chuck E. Cheese Schumer, we were there at the first Tunnel to Tower run and walked, 2002, and then 1,500 showed up, tens of thousands show up now. And after the first few appearances, the organizers had to tell me, Curtis, we can't have you speak anymore, because I would always finish off my speech and said, you know, for what they did to us on 9/11, we should put them up on the Paradise Express and zoom them all up to Allah's side. I said, hey, we're trying to get on WCBS Channel 2, and they did. And I said, yeah, no, the concept is 10,000 times more important than me being able to exercise my right of free speech.
Now, to the Bernard McGurk Studios of 77 WABC and Curtis Sliwa.
Curtis doesn't know about you, but he rips and reads.
This is the Rip and Read.
Oh, this should be the theme song for Kathy Hochul. And again, it's Hochul because she's full of nonsense, not ready for prime time. And that was obvious on the stage of the DNC convention in Chicago. She was an embarrassment to everyone in New York because she's prided herself on telling Republicans and supporters of Trump, Zeldin, Molinaro, to pack their bags and get the hell out of here. Take the Greyhound down to Florida so that on the reverse trip, the illegal aliens can jump on the bus and fill the void with their presence here that we have to pay for.
The fate of democracy in this country. That's what we're fighting for, my friends. We are fighting for democracy. We're fighting to bring government back to the people and out of the hands of dictators. And we're here to say that the era of Trump and Zeldin and Molinaro, just jump on a bus and head down to Florida where you belong, okay? Get out of town. Get out of town. Because you don't represent our values.
Right, but meantime, pay your taxes before you leave. And then she begs him to stay. Please stay. Why? Why would they stay? The fear is leading to the flight. It's continuous. And Kathy Hochul doesn't realize that. She goads you into leaving if you disagree with her, if you're not a sycophant. And we can see people are. To Virginia, North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia, Florida, Texas, Tennessee, and parts unknown. So last night, she was on the stage in Chicago at the Democratic National Convention, and I mean, nothing she said got a rise out of the crowd.
It's no wonder he had a flee to Mar-a-Lago. Sorry about that, Florida. Sorry about that.
Notice, that joke bombed. President Trump did not flee to Mar-a-Lago. He had two residences. His primary residence was New York, Trump Tower. And he, like others, decided he couldn't make this his primary residence anymore. He had to go to Florida. Boy, that joke bombed. And then she talked again, because everything last night was Trump-centric. Trump-centric.
Trump hasn't spent much time in New York lately, except that is to get convicted of 34 felonies. And that's just fine with us.
And that's all we heard all night long. It's like, okay, got it. But what are you doing up there? Then she said that we have a motto here in New York State. Now, I mean, I think I'm pretty good with my history, but I don't ever remember this. So Kathy Hochul, she alerted the entire nation and the world that was watching what the motto for New York is.
Because New York's motto is Excelsior, ever upward.
What? Could you play that again, Lou? I never heard that before.
Because New York's motto is Excelsior, ever upward.
What do you mean upward? We're on a decline. What the hell is she talking about? Excelsior? And then again, she had to do what every Democrat on the stage did there last night and become Trump-centric and slam Donald Trump.
And Trump takes us ever downward.
Well, she sounded like a Quaalude queen there. Anyway, when you look at Kathy Hochul, and again, know that I call her Hochul because she's full of nonsense. Her and her husband are the two biggest grifters who have ever existed in New York State. She ripped off the taxpayers for Buffalo Bills Stadium that we should not have been funding. Her husband owned the vending operations. He made windfall profits. You look at the IRS filings that they did, the joint account. It made more money last year than they've ever made before because everybody knows to get anything done, you got to grease Kathy Hochul, and you do it by hiring her husband for no-show jobs for business that he doesn't even attend to. They are the two grifters of New York State. And watching them on that stage last night was an absolute embarrassment. But it is a reflection of what we're stuck with. The schmuck de putz, Chuck E. Cheese Schumer, the missing in action Senator Gillibrand, and Kathy Hochul and her grifter husband. Yeah.